we'll go ahead and get started. Good evening. I'm Nicole Lavoie, the Associate Director of the Tucker Center for Research on Girls and Women in Sport, and it's my pleasure to welcome you here tonight. Thank you all for coming. The Tucker Center, as some of you may know and some of you may not know, was established in 1993 with a generous gift from Dr. Dorothy Tucker, a 1945 graduate of the University of Minnesota and a graduate of the School of Kinesiology, and I see a lot of our students in the audience as well. It was the first center of an interdisciplinary nature that is solely dedicated to research and is housed in a major research university. The Tucker Center has a threefold mission. One, to conduct research on the impact of sport in the lives of girls and women. Two, to provide first-rate educational opportunities for both graduate and undergraduate students, and to engage in community outreach and public service. The distinguished lecture brings together all parts of our mission by creating a forum that allows us to bring the best and the brightest in their respective fields to share their insights, knowledge, and expertise on various aspects of women's involvement in sport and physical activity. Tonight's panel is no exception, as we will hear from two internationally recognized scholars and experts on critical issues related to the lack of women leaders in sport organizations around the globe. Before we get to the panel, however, it's my honor to introduce our director of the Tucker Center, Professor Mary Jo Kane. She is a full professor in the School of Kinesiology and serves as the center's first and only director. Professor Kane received her PhD at the University of Illinois with an emphasis in sport sociology. She's an internationally recognized scholar who's published extensively on media representations of athletic females, as well as the social, economic, and political impact of Title IX. Professor Kane is the recipient of the first endowed chair related to women in sport, the Dorothy McNeil Tucker Chair for Women in Sport and Exercise Science. She was elected by her peers as a fellow in the National Academy of Kinesiology, which is the highest honor in her field. In 2004, she received the Scholar of the Year Award from the Women's Sport Foundation, and in 2007, Professor Kane was named one of the 100 most influential sport educators by the Institute for International Sport. And in 2012, just last spring at the Capitol, Professor Kane received a Distinguished Service Award from the Minnesota Coalition of Women in Athletic Leadership. This award is given to individuals who exemplify the highest levels of commitment and contributions to breaking barriers for girls and women in sport. It's my pleasure to recognize one of the most cutting-edge scholars and critical thinkers related to gender and sport, Professor Mary Jo Kane.
Thank you, Dr. Lavoie, for that very, really sweet introduction. The summer of 2012 was marked by three historic milestones in women's sports: the 40th anniversary of Title IX, the Summer Olympic Games in London, where for the first time in our nation history, female athletes outnumbered their male counterparts, and every country who participated in the Olympics had a female athlete on their team. After decades of being told that females aren't interested in or very good at sports, and that no one would ever watch, over the last four decades, we have witnessed some remarkable achievements. In the early 1970s, 300,000 young women played high school sports nationwide. In 2011, that number had skyrocketed to over 3 million. Before Title IX, scholarships for women were virtually unheard of, but today, 43% of all intercollegiate athletes who receive scholarships are female. Viewership and attendance records are broken every March for the women's Final Four, and NBC recently announced that coverage of the women's gymnastics finals during the 2012 U.S. Olympic trials surged 60% from their previous ratings. And speaking of the 2012 Summer Olympics, U.S. women, let me say that again, U.S. women captured 63% of all gold medals won by the American team. How about a shout out for U.S. female athletes? Unfortunately, and this is why we're here tonight, these unprecedented gains have not been matched when it comes to women occupying leadership positions, not only in the United States, but around the globe. In fact, in the wake of Title IX, females in this country have actually lost ground, and in rather dramatic fashion, all of which you will hear about this evening. And on the international stage, ascension to positions of power in such sport organizations as the IOC is even scarcer, despite women's growing participation in many countries. Why and how did this happen? And what does it matter that women occupy so few positions of power and influence when it comes to their own sports and to their own destinies? The Tucker Center has invited two internationally recognized scholars to address these and other critical questions. But before I introduce each of them, let me leave you with one final thought. In the early 1990s, I published a paper with my colleague at Smith College, Jane Stengel, on the precipitous decline of women head coaches 20 years after the passage of Title IX. In our research, we referenced a study conducted by Acosta and Carpenter, where they asked athletic administrators, those most responsible for hiring coaches, to list the most important reasons behind the diminishing number of women coaches. And here is what those ADs said: lack of qualified female coaches, failure of women to apply for job openings, a lack of qualified female administrators to mentor young coaches, and time constraints due to family obligations. My colleague and I suggested there were two major problems with the AD's analysis. First, they seemed to blame the decline solely on the individual behavior of women rather than on broader institutional factors such as gender discrimination and homophobia. Second, research at that time, which empirically tested these beliefs, revealed that female coaches were actually more qualified in terms of coaching women's sports and had more professional training and expertise than did a similar sample of male coaches. This research was, as I said, conducted two decades ago. But here is the good news. Even though this decline has become even greater over the last 20 years, our understanding for this decline, as well as the strategies needed to reverse these trends, has increased due in large measure to the two individuals we have invited here tonight. So would Professors Fink and Shaw please come now to the stage? You can hold your applause. I know you're dying to do so, but just hold on. Professor Sally Shaw is senior lecturer in the School of Physical Education at the University of Otago, New Zealand, where she teaches organizational theory and sociology. Her multifaceted research includes gender relations, nonprofit governance, organizational partnerships, and sponsorships, all linked by a central focus on organizational power, a topic on which she has published extensively. In 2011, Professor Shaw was named a research fellow of the North American Society for Sport Management. And finally, she has served as a member of the editorial review board for the Journal of Sport Management, the most prestigious academic journal in her field. Please give a warm Minnesota welcome to Professor Sally Shaw. Janet Fink is an associate professor in the Mark H. McCormick Department of Sport Management at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. Her research focuses on diversity and the marketing of female athletes and women's sports. Professor Fink has published over 50 articles and book chapters and is one of the 10 top-cited authors in the Journal of Sport Management, which, as I just mentioned, is the premier journal in her field. In 2007, she was awarded the Distinguished Teaching Award from the Ohio State University. And it actually says that in the bio, the Ohio State. You guys need to get over that. I'm sorry. And she is she's a board member of the NCAA Scholarly Colloquium. And last but not least, Professor Fink is a research fellow and acting past president of the North American Society for Sport Management. Please give her an please give an equally warm welcome to Professor Janet Fink. Thank you, and Professor Shaw, the podium is yours.
Okay, that was a tricky bit done. Thank you, Professor Kane, and I'd like to thank you for the kind invitation to present here tonight and to the Tucker Center for your hospitality over the last 3 weeks. In particular, thank you to Dr. Lavoy, Dr. Lisa Keel, and Vicky Shull for their friendship and collegiality. Thanks also to Jonathan, Maya, and Julia who have allowed me to share their office space over the last 3 weeks. And of course, it's a huge pleasure to be here sharing the stage with Dr. Fink. Okay, this slide depicts an international view of women's representation on national sport boards from 2009 to 2011. As you can see, we have just about reached the IOC's quota of 20% representation of women on national boards, 7 years after that deadline. Unfortunately, these data don't give the positions of those women on boards, so we don't know if they're chairs, CEOs, or members at large, but it gives you some idea of what's going on internationally. And as always, we can always rely on Norway to bump the numbers up for these sorts of things. In my lecture this evening, I will present a brief historical perspective on the forces that I think have been at play over the last 60 years that have led to this relatively poor showing of women on boards. I will outline some of the strategies that are in place to improve women's limited representation. While recognizing the importance of such strategies, I also critique them, arguing that the premise behind some of them is flawed. I'll suggest some alternatives to these strategies, both at the sector and local level, that may work to both improve organizational performance as well as women's representation. So here goes. Conversational sexism was rife in the 1950s when Barbara Levido, a cycling administrator and timekeeper, moved from England to New Zealand. Visiting a bike race in the nation's capital, Wellington, she introduced herself and offered to assist. She was told, "There's no bloody room for Sheilas in cycling, but you can help with the afternoon tea." In those days, ladies a plate, which was a New Zealand expression for bringing food to a potluck meal, was as far as women's involvement went in the administration of sport. This will be of no surprise to anyone in the room, and there'll be many similar examples that you can draw on from the USA, I'm sure. We can then fast forward to the mid-1980s and the changes that took place during the embrace of neoliberalism in both New Zealand and the USA. New Zealand was one of the most dynamic and aggressive implementers of neoliberal reforms, cutting the public sector, reducing jobs in the area, and changing the landscape of non-profit organizations. Your Reaganomics were our Rogernomics, named after Roger Douglas, the Minister for Finance, who was responsible for the changes in the 1980s. What did these changes mean? A revisioning of the public and non-profit sectors, rewarding organizations for efficiencies, cost-cutting, audit, arm's-length governance, accountability, and output measurement. These are not inherently bad things. However, they had significant and long-lasting impressions on sport organizations. In New Zealand, sport is almost exclusively run by non-profit organizations, and there is much similar provision in the USA once we shift our focus away from college and pro sport. Neoliberalism focuses on technocratic, audited management principles and away from communal social visions and concerns, a trend that is described by Putnam in Bowling Alone. For publicly funded sport in the 1980s and onwards, this meant a focus on outputs. For example, numbers of participants or competitors or coaches or medals won, and a focus away from how organizations were governed, particularly with regard to who was in governance roles. It didn't matter who was in governance as long as the job was done. Unsurprisingly, these neoliberal changes led to a focus on short-termism. Goalposts were frequently changed in order to reflect the demands of the government of the day, and short-term fixes were often put in place to meet funding demands. Who do people turn to in times of crisis or instability? They turn to the people they know, and when boards are dominated by men, as they were, decision makers are likely to engage in homologous reproduction, reinforcing men's positions on those boards and further undermining women. To quote Blackmore and Sachs, short-term practical knowledge to fix funding and governance crises was valued over the development of long-term knowledgeable practice to ensure sustainable boards. Neoliberal influence reforms contributed to the continued marginalization of women's representation in administration into the 1990s. To give you a New Zealand example, the Hillary Commission, which was the public funding body of sport and recreation in the 1980s and 1990s, had an award-winning women in leadership program called Winning Women. When the Hillary Commission became Sport New Zealand in the early 2000s, gender was, I quote, no longer recognized as an issue. Gender fell from the organization's priorities as it focused more on becoming the most active nation and winning medals in events that matter to New Zealanders. How these outputs were achieved and by whom was not a priority consideration. So to sum up this brief trip through history, by the late 1990s, we faced a perfect storm of 40 years in the making when Ladies of Plate met Ronnie and Roger. And so on to the 2000s, and guess what? Habitual and conversational sexism is still rife in sport administration. Dr. Fink will allude to this a little later on, but I'd like to tell you a story that happened about 3 months ago. A golf club that I know very well is having a reunion, which the men's club is largely responsible for organizing. The president asked for more women to help with things like the flower arranging that the ladies are better at doing. This comment was met with a predictably stony silence. I was there, and I looked round the table of women that I was sitting with, and I realized that sitting with me was a self-employed accountant, 2 university researchers, 2 administrators, 1 recent commerce graduate, and a greenkeeper. We could have run an entire golf club between us, never mind the reunion. The one thing we probably could not have done was the flower arranging. We are also at a time when sexism is the unmentionable ism. We've been very fortunate in New Zealand to have had at one point in the early 2000s a female prime minister, who's at the far end there, Helen Clark, a female governor general, who's nearest me here, Dame Sylvia Cartwright, which is the Queen's representative in New Zealand to make sure we all behave ourselves, and a female head of telecom, Theresa Gatting, in the middle, who was the head of telecom, one of our largest companies. Well, in some ways, this was a triumph for women. It was something of a double-edged triumph, as whenever women's issues came up in that time, we were told that sexism is done, it's finished. So within this context, this is where we find ourselves. And here I've drawn out a slightly more detailed comparison of US and New Zealand board members of Olympic sports. It's obviously quite selective, but I've tried to draw down sports that we both compete in and have both genders participating in, and you can have a bit of a look at those. I think, for me, probably the most interesting one is triathlon, and I was in Dr. Bisey's class last week, and one of the students asked about this, about how it is that triathlon, which in the 1980s had quite a strong representation of women's participation in administration, has really dropped off quite significantly. And it's a bit of an interesting history, because triathlon had a history of women's commissions in the late 70s and early 80s. It also had equal prize money, which was unusual at that time, for participants. And I think this may be a classic example of, as trends have shifted and the focus has moved away from focusing on women's issues in administration, in other words, we take the training wheels off, the numbers of administrators have dropped. And that's perhaps without a focus on long-term sustainability of our board membership. As for equestrianism, I've no idea why you need 51 people on a board, and I can only assume it's one per hoof. Okay, that's the depressing bit over, I hope. So the positive thing is that people realize there is a need to increase women's participation on boards because skills and expertise are being missed. As I've already said, the IOC had a commitment to 20% of women board members in Olympic sports by 2005. Although most countries failed pretty dismally to meet this, it did show some recognition by the IOC of the need for change. In 2010, the New Zealand Olympic Commission put in place a mentor program to encourage women up through the ranks to national and international governance. Also, relatedly, in New Zealand, the Stock Exchange has just introduced mandatory reporting of gender of board members of listed companies. And both in the UK and in New Zealand, there have been pushes to increase greater participation of women at the board level, the 25% group in New Zealand and the 20% representation in the UK. And while it's great to see these commitments and the will to increase numbers of women at board level positions, there are some critiques that I think we need to be aware of. The first of these critiques is that we simply add women and stir. Now, this has been a critique in sport sociology for many, many years. And this involves adding women into a setting where they're not welcome and not wanted. Predictably, nothing good comes of this. The barriers and constraints that were restricting women's involvement are still there. Nothing changes. Secondly, fixing women by putting them on courses such as the New Zealand Governance course puts the impetus on women as individuals to fit within a current organizational structure. Such courses do little to encourage current organizational and board members to think about what collective action could be taken to ensure that organizations are places where women want to go and are welcome. Importantly, I think we also need to look deeply at the rationale for having women on boards. The 25% group's rationale in New Zealand is that women are often the purse string holders, and they know how to tap into mothers' and children's markets. Stereotyping women as the ones who buy stuff for kids risks going down the same route as that encountered by our female coaches at the high performance level. That is, the idea that women should be interested in children, and that's it. There are also limitations of focusing only on women when they or their perceived interests are the hot topic of the day, such as getting more children involved in sport. What about women who are interested in other areas of sport administration, organization, and governance, and are still highly qualified and experienced? What happens when the hot topic focus changes? Are those women then considered redundant? Coercing organizations through reporting requirements needs to be considered with caution too. As Dr. Fink has argued in her earlier work, making organizations do something like report women's involvement can lead to limited compliance, a lack of initiative in the compliance area, and a low level of organizational commitment to diversity. So, here are some suggestions for change. They are presented within the Critical Management Studies framework, a research framework that puts people at the center of organizational decisions. The first is organizational reflection. And the first question within that is, why do we want more women on boards? Are we, as organizations, ticking a box or filling a quota? Or do we truly believe that women are part of our workforce or volunteer body and should be an integral part of our organization's makeup? Secondly, when we think about the best person for the job, what are the assumptions that drive our decisions? Are we really looking at the best people or the people we know the best? A short-term fix over longer-term investment in knowledgeable practice? Do we, within our organizations, look for the skills that we need or an easy out based on who we know? The second part of this framework is cultural awareness and critique. What are our organizations like to newcomers? do we put the impetus on women to prove themselves without strong support mechanisms, which we should have in place for any CEO? Do we create what has been labeled by Ryan and Haslam in 2004 a glass cliff, a situation in which an organization is applauded for breaking the glass ceiling by hiring a female CEO, but appoints her to an organization in crisis, does not support her, or does not value her experiences and qualifications, leading to a self-fulfilling prophecy of failure? Or do we put in place the informal and formal support mechanisms that anyone starting a new role needs? As Myerson and Kolb and Eli and Myerson have found, this sort of organizational reflection takes time, organizational commitment, and some honest thought, and is not always easy. So here are some ways that I think we can make small changes that may make big changes. We need to focus on what women bring to an organization in terms of skills, experience, and qualifications. If they are the lawyers, accountants, advocates, administrators, and marketers that we need, then we must open the same doors to them that we open to our, at times, less experienced and less skilled men. We must not assume that women don't want to be involved at the board level or lack experience. Indeed, Singh et al. Found that far from being inexperienced, women who do get on boards are often younger and have better qualifications than their male peers. They are both ready and truly able to get on the board and take up a board position. Seemingly tiny changes can have strong impacts. Research with coaches suggests that even the smallest thing, such as funding childcare arrangements and changing meeting times, can make huge differences to women who are still the majority as primary childcare providers. If a woman has the skills, qualifications, and experience to do the job, then we should look at facilitating her long-term involvement. As organizational members, we should enhance their potential involvement by addressing circumstances that can be changed. We need to ensure that our doors are open. Research suggests that while female and male graduates may leave university with similar experiences and expectations, men had more doors open to them through informal networks. As organizational members, how can we collectively ensure that we open doors and encourage organizations to open doors to young women? How do we ensure that those who want to rise up to the national level and international level in administration can do so? Again, by focusing on what our organization does to support women, recognizing their skills and experiences. We live in a time where sustainability is increasingly important. So let's start thinking sustainably about our appointments at the board level. These changes will improve our organizations as well as open up more opportunities for women. So to conclude, we need to recognize and value the will to increase numbers of women on boards in the private and public sectors. But it's how we go about framing that development that is important. As ever, we need to be aware of tokenism. Short-term fixes are just that, and hot topics can become quite cool quite quickly. We are organizational members, and it is our responsibility to make sure that our organizations are spaces where collective, long-term responsibility for board membership is taken seriously. Let's get the right person for the job, but frame rightness the same way for women as for men. Skills, qualifications, experiences. And as ever, as women and men who have diversity at heart, we have to stand up, say our piece, and be counted again. Thank you.
Well, first I'd like to thank Dr. Mary Jo Kane and Dr. Nicole Lavoie, for inviting me to be a part of the Distinguished Lecture Series for the Tucker Center. I'm quite humbled, and I have been inspired throughout my academic career by Dr. Kane's work. It has inspired my research for a really long time, as well as Dr. Shaw's. And so I feel like I'm in pretty select company up here, and I'm really happy to be here. And I'd like to thank Jonathan Sweet for getting all this arranged over here, our technology. I wouldn't have been able to do this, so I really appreciate that. Unfortunately, the tenor of my lecture is rather bleak, not that Sally's wasn't. But that's not because I'm an inherent pessimist. It's because the facts of women in sport leadership positions in America is paints a pretty chilling picture. And at this point in time, I want to tell you that I am a huge sports fan, men and women. Dr. Lavoy and I were discussing who the coach for Notre Dame should start at quarterback, because you know we're experts in that. And you won't find, this won't be popular in this room, but you won't find a bigger Buckeye football fan than, because I also did my undergraduate work there. So, you know, you become indoctrinated. But I think it's important for me to tell you that, because as I go through this, it may sound like I don't like men's sports or I don't like football, but it's just that I don't let my fandom get in the way of seeing that there is a problem, okay? So, with that being said, let me take a step back and just give you some numbers about women in the workforce in general, not sport. Since 1981, women have comprised at least 50% of college graduates. And in fact, in 2010, 57% of college graduates were women, and that continues to rise. In 2011, women comprised 47% of the overall workforce and 59% of entry-level college-educated workforce workers. However, in 2012, there were still only 12 women leading Fortune 500 companies in the U.S., and women still earn only 77 cents to every man's dollar. So no doubt there's still a women's problem in the workforce in America. But some would argue that this is even worse in sport, because while we've increased participation for young girls and women at such an incredible rate, I mean, it's unbelievable. The fact of the matter is that we're losing ground, as Dr. Kane said, in terms of leadership positions. One of the unintended consequences of Title IX was that as women's sports became more legitimate, female leaders exited or were ousted, however you want to look at it. But Acosta and Carpenter's data shows that in 1973, 90% of athletic directors of women's programs were female. But today, in 2012, of all athletic directors in the United States, females make up only 20% of them. Unfortunately, for us football lovers, the numbers get even worse when you go to FBS subdivision schools like the University of Minnesota or Ohio State. Only 4.9% of ADs at all of those schools are women. And even more, I think, telling is that those schools average only 1.4 female administrators per administration. When you sometimes have a senior women's administrator who typically is a woman, that's very few. And there are 411 fewer females in administrative positions today than there were in 2008. And it doesn't get much better when you think about coaching. While a little over half of women's teams are coached by women, of course, we don't even think about women coaching men's teams. That's silly, right? So, at the professional ranks, this slide gives you some idea of how females fare in different leagues. The Institute for Diversity and Ethics in Sport provides a grade card for all of the professional leagues in America. And this year, the WNBA received an A-, but I would contend that that's because they're being graded on a scaled, you know, it's graded on a scale, because the rest of the league's numbers are so incredibly, abysmally low. If you see, the WNBA is certainly doing much better than all other leagues, but women still don't make up a majority of head coaches, only 3% of CEOs, 33% of GMs, and 25% of VPs. A look at the other sports, though, is way worse. No head coaches, no GMs, very few VPs or senior administrators. And even on like the medical side of things, zero head athletic trainers. So there's just no place for female leadership in professional sports outside of the WNBA, it seems. In the business literature, this would have been termed a few years ago the glass ceiling, which implies that there are invisible factors, not overt discrimination, that keep women from advancing to these higher ranks. Recently, though, Eagley and Carly suggested this glass ceiling metaphor is really not any longer valid. They say that, worst of all, by depicting a single, unvarying obstacle, the glass ceiling fails to incorporate the complexity and variety of challenges that women can face in their leadership journeys. In truth, women aren't turned away only as they reach the penultimate stage of a distinguished career. They disappear in various numbers at many points leading up to that stage. And so they've suggested that actually a more apt metaphor is a labyrinth, because there are so many different ways that women can get caught up in obtaining these leadership positions. And this actually works out really well with some work that's been done in sport by Cunningham and Sagas, who suggested that the lack of women in leadership positions is actually a very complex, multi-level process, and that you have micro-level forces, meso-level forces, and macro-level forces that all are operating at the same time and prohibiting women from ascension to these higher ranks. So I'm going to go through just a few studies in each level to show you what's been done, but please keep in mind that they don't operate in isolation. They often operate in tandem. So micro-level forces, as Dr. Kane said, typically focus on individual females and their attributes, or more likely, their lack thereof, for why they don't ascend to leadership positions. But it is true that men tend to overestimate their abilities, while women consistently tend to underestimate theirs. Studies have shown this. And when men are successful, they rightly so attribute it to their own talents, where, you know, I'm smart, I'm good at this, where women are more likely to say, I got lucky, I had a good mentor, I had lots of help. And that's really nice, we're humble, but sometimes I think it can really harm women in the long run. For example, it's been shown that people in general tend to think that men are smarter than women. Fernham did a cross-cultural study of intelligence, and he found that men, again, consistently overestimate their intelligence and women consistently underestimate theirs. However, what's really sort of sad about this research is that this happens across genders and across generations. So both men and women think that men are smarter. Both men and women think that their sons are smarter than their daughters. And both men and, or little girls and little boys, think that their fathers are smarter than their mothers. That's what the research shows. How does this impact sport? Well, research also shows that elite female coaches are not willing to put their papers in, or they won't apply for a job if they're missing even one aspect of the job qualification. However, male coaches don't hesitate to put their stuff in, even if they're missing a few qualifications. And there's nothing wrong with that. I'm just suggesting that there's differences in the way men and women behave. And this doesn't just happen at the elite level. For example, Mesner did an in-depth study of youth soccer, and one of the few female coaches who coached soccer said this: for some reason, men, it just doesn't matter to them that they never played or they don't know the game. They think they know, so they're the ones out there doing it. So At the meso level of analysis, the focus is on organizational level factors that tend to sustain the gendered nature of sports, such as leadership behavior or policies. Some of these are quite simple. For example, many times female administrators aren't given the ability to oversee the marquee men's sports, i.e. men's basketball and football. It may seem more natural to have women oversee women's sports, but when then they go to apply for an athletic director's position, they don't have that required element, and so they are less likely to get that job. Some things, however, are a little more complex. Other studies have demonstrated, and Dr. Keynes was one of the first way back in the 90s, to show that homologous reproduction exists in intercollegiate athletics, which suggests that the dominant coalition, or the majority of those in power, and that's usually white males, tend to be more likely to hire someone like them because consciously or unconsciously, they desire to maintain their power, thus resulting in what's called an old boys network. So what I did to see if this is true is I graphed the data from Acosta and Carpenter's most recent report. The yellow line represents the percentage of female coaches when there's no female in the athletic administrative structure. The red line represents the percentage of female coaches when there's a female athletic director. And the light blue line represents the percentage of female coaches of women's teams for all types of administrative structures. As you can see, the lowest percentage of female coaches occurs in administrative structures with no females. And given the vast differences in the red and yellow lines, homologous reproduction occurs both ways, so we do it too. However, given the paltry numbers of women in leadership positions, the strength of the old girls network will never become that of the strength of the old boys network. So homologous reproduction still exists. Macro level forces are those outside or surrounding the organization or individual, and these are the most pervasive and by far the most difficult to combat. Numerous studies have shown that there's a definite gender bias in the workplace, particularly when we're assessing leadership effectiveness. Folks have done tons of studies where managers or leaders are described in meticulous detail, their actions, their outcomes, their qualifications. The only thing that they change in these studies is the leader's name, Heidi or Harold, for example. And in study after study after study, people rate Harold much more effective as a leader than they do Heidi, even though there was nothing different about them except for their name. Now, Valium would suggest, or suggested a long time ago, that this is a work of gender schemas, which are implicit hypotheses about sex differences that are taught early in life. So, for example, if you think about it, if you ask the majority of Americans, picture a head coach, most of them are going to picture a man, right? Eagley and her colleagues explain this through social role theory, and it's just a little bit more nuanced than that. And they would say that there are expectations regarding the roles that men and women play, but also the behavior qualities that they should exhibit. So women, Eagley and colleagues have demonstrated throughout numerous studies over the years that women, people associate women with communal qualities, which convey a concern for the compassionate treatment of others, and you can see some of these on the slide, whereas men are associated with agentic qualities, and these convey assertion and control, and some of these are shown on the slide. Agentic qualities are automatically associated with effective leadership, and so men are automatically deemed to be more effective leaders when people see them. Unfortunately, there's something called a double bind, and that is when women do act in agentic manners, so they're decisive, ambitious, self-confident, they're judged more poorly because they're acting outside of their traditional gender roles, whereas if they don't exhibit those agentic qualities, well, then they're just a terrible leader. So this is what's called a double bind, and I think that this comic strip gets at it pretty well. And in fact, the reversal of the stereotype sort of highlights its irrationality. So studies have also shown that this double bind also exists in sport. One of my colleagues from the University of Connecticut replicated these gender bias studies, but she did it with Division I intercollegiate athletic administrators. And so the qualifications of the male and female applicants were exactly the same, only their name was changed. And consistent with social role theory, women applying for AD positions were rated significantly more masculine or less feminine than a female applying for a life skills coordinator position. Also, the women were applying for the athletic director's position were seen as having more agentic traits than the woman applying for the life skills coordinator position, and as many as the man applying for an AD position. So that would suggest that they should both be chosen at the same rate for an AD's position. However, participants in the study indicated that applicants were significantly more likely to be chosen for the athletic director's position if they were male. And this suggests that regardless of qualifications, there's still this perceived lack of fit for female candidates applying for these sorts of positions. So we have these macro, micro, and meso-level forces operating simultaneously to serve as barriers. And this news is bad enough. However, and I do this with hesitation, but I want to point out a meso-level barrier that I think operates with such force and is so insidious in sport that we often don't even recognize it. I contend that sport is one of the few arenas where sexism is still overtly demonstrated, maybe unconsciously, yet remains largely unrecognized, let alone challenged by the majority of its constituents. In sport, if you think about this, sexist acts are ignored, giggled about, or accepted when similar racist acts would be deemed discriminatory in some manner. I am not up here trying to pit one ism against another. I find all discrimination reprehensible. However, what I'm trying to suggest, and I'll do this, I think, a little bit in the next few slides, is that sexism is one of the few isms that still goes unnoticed or uncontested in sport. Let me just give you a few examples, okay? So a few years ago, Boston Celtics radio announcer Cedric Maxwell felt that Violet Palmer, who's an NBA ref, made a bad call during the Celtics game. On the air, he said, "Go back to the kitchen. Go back there and make me some bacon and eggs, would you?" Very few media outlets reported this, and there was certainly no national public outcry. And in fact, when I show this to my classes, invariably they laugh, okay? I realize that. But if you imagine substituting a similar racist or homophobic slur in there, and imagine the publicity that would ensue, I think you see what I'm trying to get at. Similarly, in 2012, just earlier this year, Jason King, who I love as an ESPN writer, wrote a piece in ESPN on Andrea Hootie. She's the first and still only female strength coach of any men's sport that in intercollegiate athletics at the Division I level. And in it, Bill Self, head of the Kansas men's basketball team, is quoted as saying, "I didn't want to hire her." Lou Perkins, then the AD at Kansas at the time, would say, "Oh, if you meet her just once, you're going to love her." But I kept saying, "I don't want to hire a woman to be a men's strength coach." I meant, who does that? Again, substitute any other demographic variable in there, and I don't think that this would be allowed. So just one more example. In the 1990s, at the time of the PGA Championship, Shoal Creek was a golf club that was holding that championship, and it didn't happen to allow black members. When this was brought to light, the lead sponsor, IBM, backed out. Other sponsors soon followed. Players threatened a boycott. CBS said that they weren't going to show it. And soon the course was pressured into saying, okay, we'll allow some black members to play. However, if you remember, when Martha Burke protested the Masters in 2003, because of Augusta National's policy prohibiting female members, IBM stuck by the tournament, as did all other sponsors, You didn't hear a word about CBS not showing the Masters, oh my goodness. And there were no threats of player boycotts. So obviously it wasn't until this year that Augusta just finally invited female membership, which is great, but vastly different reactions to sexism and racism in the golf industry. So I could go on forever, but I won't. I think you get the idea that there's this uncontested sexism in sport. So what can we do about it? How can we make things better? Well, first, I think that those who want to support women in sport, we need to learn some lessons from the activists who have fought battles before us for other minority groups. Take the LGBT community, for example. It wasn't too long ago that a phrase in sport like, "that's so gay," or calling someone a pejorative term for a gay man, it would have been ignored as well. But nowadays, that becomes big news, and people have to apologize for it. Today, we have athletes who have come out, professional athletes who speak on the behalf of gay marriage. The NCAA has even developed a policy for transgendered athletes. I mean, a whole lot of progress in a very little bit of time. This progress was made because leaders like Pat Griffin took her knowledge and partnered with advocacy groups to develop initiatives for athletes, parents, et cetera, to make sports more inclusive. As researchers in this area, I realize that we need to do more of this. Certainly, the Tucker Center is a great example of this happening, but you have to recognize this is one-of-a-kind thing that is the exception to the rule, and we need to do much more of it. As educators and parents and advocates, we need to educate girls and women, as well as boys and men, about the micro, meso, and macro level forces operating against the rise of female leaders and constantly reinforce that girls' and women's abilities to take on leadership positions are just as strong as men's. The LGBT community also, though, has incredibly committed activists who vigilantly monitor the sport landscape and bring national and international attention to discriminatory acts, policies, etc. And they also celebrate inclusive acts. We need similar efforts to highlight at a national or international level that sexism in sport, because it's impossible to fight an invisible foe. As long as sexism is just taken for granted, giggled about, whatever, change is impossible. And similarly, we need to celebrate organizations, policies, procedures, and individuals that advocate for inclusivity for female sport leadership at all levels. I sincerely believe that our advancement in this realm has ramifications way beyond sport. Mary Jo Cain calls sport one of the most powerful economic, social, and political institutions on the planet. And as usual, she's right. And because of that, sport organizations and its leaders have to acknowledge and help remedy these barriers, and we must insist that they do that. McDonough and Papineau claim the next frontier in the history of achieving rights for women in the U.S. is sports. As sports participants, we've made unbelievable strides. Now we need to fight to match that ascension in leadership roles. Thank you.
Dr. Shaw and Dr. Fink are getting settled. Let's reflect on their comments. There's a lot of issues that they touched on tonight that many of us in the room think quite a bit about. And I think there's a lot of good knowledge in this room, and I'm hoping that we have some really good questions. We've got some mics, and we'll open it up for questions. But I'll start us off tonight. Thank you both. That was really a wonderful summary and presentation, not only from issues in the U.S., but in New Zealand as well. And even though our countries are quite different, we're facing many similar battles. So thank you for that. I was thinking about something I saw via social media in the last day or two, and you mentioned the gender wage gap, that women on average make about 70 cents per dollar that men make. And some argue that that's closing with education, that educated women are earning more, and other data says not. And in fact, I think that's bearing out that even with education, the gap isn't closing as quickly as we would like. And I think one study said if you had the line going out, it would be some 60 to 70 years before the gap closed at the current rate that it's going. But they also made an interesting point, which got me thinking, was that if we put women in positions of power, and we leveled the gender pay gap, that it would be enough to stimulate the economy. And that really took me. So maybe can you just comment on that, and then we'll open it up for questions. Do you think that's true?
Dr. Lavoie, I have no idea if we can, like, I'm talking about gender equity. How do I know? I don't know. Would it stimulate the economy? It'd have to, right?
It would, I would think.
I would think, but wouldn't it? I don't know. I have no idea, really.
I just thought that was interesting because we're arguing for more women in positions of power, which then would have a lot of different implications and ramifications.
But wouldn't the money just be distributed to a different person?
I don't know.
I don't know. That's beyond my level of
expertise. We'll have the economist panel next spring. Okay, fair
enough. Let's come back to that one at the end,
okay,
shall
we? Okay, we'll ponder that one
for a
moment.
Give us a warm-up one.
Okay, well, that was not a softball, was it?
That was soft?
No. All right, let's open it up. We've got some mics in the back, John and Jessica. So who has a question? Don't be shy. I'm looking at my students in the corner over here. Don't make me call on you. Here's Beth has a question down here.
I just have a question about how this might all relate to youth sport and if that is a place that women could potentially start. I have two sons who unfortunately for me play hockey, and I look at the board and I mean there's out of 20 people there's probably two women. So I'm just wondering if that's a place to start, or how does this all relate to boards like in the youth sport, which is obviously more common than and more widespread than national organizations.
So in the U.S. context, it's really interesting, and Dr. Lavoie has actually done some research on this. And Mesner's study, which has been turned into a book, and it's called "It's All for the Kids," I think, shows that even at the youth level, those organizations are very gendered. And so the women are tagged to be the soccer mothers, you know, and not the soccer coaches. And Dr. Lavoie's work has shown that even women who have been intercollegiate athletic soccer players, when it comes time to coach their youth sports teams, they say, oh, I don't know if I know enough yet to coach it, right? And so I wish that were true, that that would be the place that we could start, but I'm afraid that the research would suggest that this gendered nature of things is just being reinforced there in the American setting.
Mm-hmm. And probably also in the New Zealand setting. However, what I would say is that I'm assuming when you say youth sport, you're meaning a local league, yeah. Yeah, okay. So I guess the flip side to that is you have to start somewhere, and there is also research to suggest that, you know, if we can get more women involved at the local levels, then at least the possibility of them moving up into national and international boards is greater, just through a sort of critical mass type argument, I suppose. But at the same time, those organizations, as Dr. Fink quite rightly says, are highly gendered. And so it's finding those positions and, again, turning the responsibility onto the organizations of, you know, who do they want on boards and why, and recognizing that women come to those boards with the skills and qualifications and so on, and valuing those as they do for men. And that's more of, I think, a cultural thing. But You have to start somewhere. There's no doubt about that. Yeah. I think so.
Hi. Okay. You mentioned that women are routinely getting passed over for the athletic director positions, even when they're equally as qualified. So my question then is, where do those women end up? If they're getting, you know, it seems to me that then there should be a lot of really qualified women out there. What positions are they winding up in, and why are they not all rallying together?
Well, you know, that's a very good question. The study that I referenced in terms of the athletic directors, it was actual made up, applicants. So I think that you have a lot of things operating at that level. Probably not as many women apply for the positions. You have what we suggested was a gender bias in the choices too. And I don't know why women don't rally a little bit more as a result of being passed over for athletic directors' positions. I think that's a really good point.
This may be outside of what you can predict or give an answer for, but it seems to me that we've had an incredible amount of research done, years of education, lots of things going on since Title IX, and yet we seem to almost be further from the goal. And I can't stand it anymore. No. What is it that we are doing incorrectly, or what change in action on our part as far as women, or maybe the part of men, has to happen in order for this start to correct itself? Because it seems like we've put in an inordinate amount of work with less than 100% results.
No, not even 25%.
Except in Norway. In terms of the policies that are in place, such as Title IX, I think the example of the reduced numbers of female ADs and other administrators is an unintended consequence, perhaps, of a policy like that. That it's had huge positive implications for participation, but administrative reversal, if you like, that no one anticipated. And that often happens with policies, that a policy is put in place with the best will in the world, and yet something else happens that we never anticipated. So, and maybe that's the position that we're in now. We're 40 years on with Title IX, and it's had a long time to bed in and to see what the outcomes of it have been. And perhaps we are at a time now where we need to start taking on some of the responsibility of the knock-on effects of that policy, and do some of the things that Janet and I have mentioned this evening, and shift our focus, perhaps, as you say, away from what we've traditionally looked at, which has been the big policies quite often, and shift it to looking at, well, what has worked in organizations? And I know that can seem like a lot of work on individuals sometimes, that, oh gosh, we've got to do this all over again. But if we can get organizations to own their changes, then they become changes that people want. They're not imposed upon people. And that is a huge difference for the success and the sustainability of change. Rather than it being imposed, being a top-down policy, it's something that organizations actually want to do.
Do you want to add to that, Janet? Hang on, can you give her the mic? We've got to capture this for in perpetuity, Mary Jo. There we go.
So as a scholar who's done some research in this area, and I know that we are all scholars who've done research, and there's some folks in here who are academics, but I personally often worry that we're not talking enough to the people in the trenches to answer your question, which is, okay, so what are we going to do about it? How can we make this change? And without calling out particular individuals in the audience, I see a lot of people in here who are current coaches, athletic administrators, former athletic administrators. If one or some of you would be willing to say, if you were in charge of solving this problem, and if there was one strategy you could put in place, what would that strategy be? Because we need to know those answers. So anybody want to say, or do you want me to like actually call somebody out?
This is going to get good.
Pardon me?
This will get good.
Yeah.
Or the students in the audience, or the future leaders. What do you guys think?
For those of you who do not know, I would like to graciously hand over the mic to our athletic director at the University of Minnesota, Norwood Teague.
And I'm going to give it to our former athletic director in a minute after me. Athletic, are you emeritus yet? Are we calling you that, Joel Maturi? Hey, you know what I'd like to see? I think that, I'm not disagreeing with any of your stats. I agree with all of them. I think it's a numbers game sometimes. And I don't know if we're doing enough with the young women from a career standpoint, at least on the administrative side in college athletics. We're not doing enough with programs to cultivate them in their 20s, in their early 30s, to advance up the ladder to become athletic directors. I think, you know, we're doing a good job, and I think, I don't know, Joel, what the program is at the NCAA. It's the minority career cultivation advancement. Lynn, you're nodding your head that they do at NACTA. And I think that's very good because it produces and elevates a lot of minorities to pursue college administration, to network, to develop, you know, what they need around them. But I don't think we do enough on the women's side to cultivate women up the ladder, whether it be programs, networking, concepts. I just don't see it there. And I think that as a result, you don't have a lot of women that are in the pipeline. I mean, there's some, but there's just not enough. I mean, there's certain jobs that we'll have open here in the next 5 to 6, 7 years. I'd love to hire a female, but to be quite honest with you, when certain jobs come open, you'll have 15 men apply. And I just think we need to do more at the grassroots level to cultivate them from a career standpoint. You guys agree or disagree? I'd love to hear what you have to say.
I totally agree with you. I think that's right on, yeah.
I'll try to add to that, if I may, Norwood. I think even the statistics, and I agree with Norwood, I think that obviously you've done the research and it's there, but I think we have to be careful about the numbers being misleading as well. When you mentioned, years ago there were X number of female administrators and then male administrators, well, that's because there were female programs and they combined and became only one athletic director versus two, which was experienced in Minnesota just 10 years ago. So you got to be careful with that statistic. And then the other statistic
you
mentioned.
Well, yes, but the thing is, every time they became merged,
In most cases, it was men. I understand that. No, I agree with that. No, 100% agree. But I'm just saying, but the other statistic is, you said this was 1.4 females per athletic administration, which again shows you, as I think Norwood was trying to say, there aren't as many in the pool as there needs to be. That's the point I'm trying to make. And I think the only way you solve this is you do what the Olympic committees have tried to do, or at least said that they would do. I think you have to put a number on it. I think you have to say, and educational institutions should be able to do that. The NCAA should be able to do that. By X number of years, there will be 30%, there'll be 40%, there'll be whatever it is. So you, in essence, mandate the number of females that would be part of the athletic administration, which to me then would create the pipeline, which would make more females available to hopefully be ADs of men's and women's programs.
Oh, go ahead, Steph.
I'd like to ask Mr. Teague, short of Mitt Romney's solution of binders full of women, what you might do to replace and expand the opportunities for women administrators, since you just dismissed the only woman administrator in your athletic department. What are you going to do personally to assure us that you're going to get highly qualified women in that position and even more positions?
Well, I think open up the jobs and recruit. I think, you know, I don't want to, certainly, I was telling a group a little bit earlier, don't want to post a job and just wait for applications to come in. I think you got to go out and you got to recruit. And I would like to see more women here and everywhere, not just in SWA roles. That's what I was, the development portion I was talking about, because, you know, that SWA is, I mean, it should always be a woman, and it will be here, but we need more in development and, you know, ticket office or other realms as well.
Are there more strategies in the audience? There's Diane back here.
Not knowing a lot of statistics, but wasn't there an argument around African Americans in coaching football, that there just weren't enough qualified African Americans to be football coaches in the NFL? Can you talk to that?
Well, I'm sure most people in here are aware of the Rooney Rule, but in professional sport, because there was a lack of African American head coaches, the NFL decided that they would institute the Rooney Rule, which is that anytime they interview for a head coaching position, they must interview at least one African American for that position. And so some have suggested, actually, and I almost put it in my presentation, but Mary Jo is she's a stickler about time. So, why not a Rooney Rule? Not only for females in intercollegiate athletics, but also similarly for, there aren't very many head coaches of intercollegiate football that are African American males as well. The NCAA has consistently taken the line that it's a member organization, so they can't institute that policy because everyone could carry it out differently. But they institute other policies, so I've never quite understood that rationale as much. But they've been entirely hands-off. They don't want to do any sort of thing about a Rooney Rule for gender or for race, as far as I know.
You know, what's interesting about that, though, that doesn't preclude an individual institution from making a policy aside from the NCAA.
Absolutely right.
But Janet, you said one thing that struck me, too, is that when we have policies or quotas in place, that organizations often feel coerced, and then it has a limited effect. So I'm wondering, you know, would that be an effective way? It might be a starting point.
So when they instituted the Rooney Rule, I thought to myself, this will never work because, you know, organizations don't like to be coerced. But clearly I didn't know much about that, and I was wrong because it has worked very well. I'm not sure about that. The research suggests over and over in organizations that if you force numbers or quotas, that people have higher stereotypes about the people who then are filling those positions, whether it's true or not. And so there's this level of tokenism, and they feel resentful, and that they feel like instead of this embracing of diversity, we have to do this. Mm. So instead of doing it because we want to do it, we're doing it because we have to do it. So I really don't know the answers to all of these things.
And I would like to see us move to that we should do it.
Good luck with that.
I think, Nicole, can I just answer that?
Oh, that was a hands are up. Sally, you respond, and then we'll go to
the
audience.
I think we're in a bit of danger here of going to an either-or situation as well, and I think we need to be really wary of that. I think there is definitely room to bring through more women and to encourage them to, you know, be at that whatever level. But at the same time, I think we can also put the emphasis on organisations to make change. So, yes, perhaps there does need to be, you know, a bit of a carrot and stick going on, because that may generate some change. But I think to get into an either or is very problematic.
For the two US boards that Dr. Shaw noted there was some gender balance, track and field and equestrian, have there been any observable differences in how those boards have administered the sport or issues they focused on as a result? And should there be?
I don't know. It's a great question. I slightly guess, and I'm only guessing, that there might be some policy in place for track and field in terms of representation, but I'm only guessing about that. Someone in the audience may have a better idea. But I don't know.
I wonder if you have studied other professions where women are more successful or worse in situation, and to find out what factors actually influence these gender equities. I would think maybe nursing would be in one example that maybe there are more women. I don't know if they have their deans are always women, but I would guess my colleagues would probably confirm it. But there will be some worse professions. So by comparing these professions, could you learn something out of it?
Well, I think what we learn when we compare the professions, that the professions where women have the greatest majority are those that are much lower paid than the professions where the male is the majority. So you mentioned nurses, but why not doctors? You see what I'm saying? Well, nurses don't get paid as much. It's not as a highly esteemed profession. And so in the most highly esteemed, highly paid professions, men are always the majority of the worker, of the leaders.
And also, may I chip in? As professions professionalize, they often go from being administrated by women or a mix of women and men to just men. So if you think of, sport is a good example.
Education.
Disability sport was an area that had a large number, certainly in the UK, a large number of female coaches. And then as more funding was put into that area of sport and it became seen as a legitimate profession, you saw many more men coming into those roles because they saw it as a professional, as a profession, and partly for the reasons that Janet's outlined. And that's the case across other industries too. For example, a lot of women cook, but most well-paid male chefs are male, you know. Yeah, so it does happen in other professions too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Lily. Kari?
Yeah, my name's Kari Hogg. I'm a golf course architect and a big advocate for women's golf in Minnesota. And one thing that we've been doing is I've brought together a group of women that are leaders in the golf world here in Minnesota, and looking at how do we get more women leaders in positions within the leadership and governance, within the careers, getting more women in the pro shop. I did a little bit of research in 2010. There were only 1.7% of head pros were female. So we've looked at some of this, like Norwood was talking about the career cultivation and how do we get women brought up into those roles. And I was wondering if you could say anything more about career cultivation, how we might be able to do that. The other thing is looking at Title IX, and I think with Title IX we had federal dollars and the legal system that were attached to that. So my next question would be, what is the next big thing? Title IX was a big thing, but it was 40 years ago. What is the next big thing? And what dollars do we attach to it? And how is that going to be dealt with through the legal system? And then the third thing I wanted to bring up.
Okay, Kari, stop there now.
I could go on forever. I'll stop. Okay. But we can talk more about it.
Okay. Go with the career cultivation.
I'm on number one.
it's getting late.
Yeah. Again, I think, great question. Golf is a classic example. Again, I think it's a two-pronged attack, if you like, both in terms of enabling, encouraging young women to network, to develop, to be out there, and being, you know, valuing their own experiences, their own skills as much as the guys value their own experiences and skills, and giving them the opportunities to be in those communities and be working. And at the same time, so that's kind of on the young women and on us as educators, but also at the same time, in our golf clubs, in our associations, at our board levels, just having a pause and saying, what is going on here in our organization in terms of encouraging these young women? And it doesn't have to be a great seismic event. Small changes can have huge implications. And I think that if we can make that manageable for organizations, we've got a much better chance of encouraging them to want to include women than the big policy. That's what I personally believe. As for Title IX,
you know, I honestly don't know. I don't foresee me, and I'm really not an inherent pessimist, but I don't see a next big, huge sort of federal legislation that's going to be aimed at sport that deals really with females. I just don't see that happening anytime soon. Maybe something like a Rooney Rule, but it would be more all-encompassing, and I doubt that it would be tied to any sort of funding. And so it wouldn't, and none of those would help you in golf as much. So I don't know, but certainly other people may have other ideas. That's just my sort of perspective. But you guys may think differently.
Can I just come back on that? I think, Janet, when you say, you know, there might not be a sole thing, I see that as really positive. Because I think when you present a strategy, you can be ignoring lots of other strategies. And so sometimes, although it makes life a bit messy, you can have many different ways in which things can work. And if you've got organizations working in the ways that work for them to make these changes, why should there be one single sole strategy? Why should there be a state or a federal, whatever it is, policy if we can work out ways to get organizations to get there by themselves? So I think that perhaps not having the strategy might be a good thing.
And in building on that, it might also lead to less unintended consequences because it's at a more localized
perhaps
level that's tailored to that group.
Yeah, it's different at least.
Mm-hmm.
It's different.
Let's take one last question and then we'll wrap it up. Leo, was that a hand? Sure. Oh, Kim, were you waiting? Kim, give the mic to Kim. And then we'll end with Leo. And
Two more. Well, thank you. And thank you for being here, for your life's work. It's been important to people such as myself that have had an opportunity in intercollegiate athletics, both as a Division I coach and now as a sitting Division III athletic administrator. Just a couple of notes that I would say to bring to your attention: the National Association of Collegiate Women Athletic Administrators, NACWA, is a large, vibrant, energized, and healthy organization that is promoting and supporting and teaching and working together with administrators that are currently in intercollegiate athletics and those up and coming. The Alliance for Women Coaches is also a very large group and energized group that's important in terms of our search for women's coaches, both sitting coaches and up and coming. So those are two very significant organizations that we should be in touch with and we should be very close with. The other thing I would say too is, as you look at administrators, I'll get my numbers close here. Division III athletic administrators, 144 women in Division III, 42 in Division II, and 13 in Division I. And yet there's 9,000 jobs being held by women in Division I. So my sense is there are women that are up and coming and are working in intercollegiate athletics in a way that they can prepare to be leaders in the future of our institutions. One of the questions I would ask you that I noticed in doing a recent presentation is that as we look at the percentage of women's coaches, which is of strong concern to me, 42.7%, I think, as you said, overall in all three divisions. But as I look at that, there's a consistent 50% ratio in the high premier sports, basketball, volleyball, softball, soccer, 52 to 47%. And my sense is that economics have been a strong factor in men entering into those sports. Field hockey and lacrosse, 95 and 98% are being coached by women, so they're obviously doing something right. But as you look at the other sports, and this is something that had really just come to my mind, is they're co-ed in nature. And so, you know, even as I look at my staff here, who I'm really proud to be joined by, we had a head golf coach that happened to be a woman coaching both our men's and women's golf teams. And where you're starting to see these things get seriously skewed is where you have the cross-gendered sports, men's and women's swimming and diving, men's and women's tennis, men's and women's golf, and they are 16% to 27%, very, very low. And I'm not sure that as women in our field that we've approached these dual-gendered sports and the leadership in those particular sports, because I think we would see some very strong opportunities to move women into coaching. Cross-country, track and field, the numbers are very, very low. But I'm just curious if you have any perspective or have seen any research indicating opportunities for growth in those cross-gendered sports where head coaches now are predominantly male.
But, I mean, that is true, and you seem to know the research actually better than I do, so I don't even know why I'm giving this answer, but wow, I mean, that was really impressive. But what I was going to say is that, however, when women do get to coach at any point a man's sport, it's at those dual level sports, right? I mean, you're not going to see a woman coach baseball. You're not going to see a, I mean, you don't. You don't see women coach baseball. You don't see women coach basketball. You don't see women coach whatever that's not non-dual. Where you do see the women coaches, in my statistics, they were dual team coaches. So I think that they are entering in that phase, and I think it's great, because I think that as men begin to realize that it's not that big of a deal to have a female as a head coach, then pretty soon it will become normal, right? Right now, it's not normal for men's basketball players to think, oh, I could be coached by a woman. There's nothing to say that it wouldn't be normal, but they've just never had it before. So as more boys and men and whatever grow up and have these women in these dual coaching roles, you're right, it could be very helpful. And maybe that is an indoor that we should look at. Mm. It's a really good point.
Thanks, Kim. All right, Leo, you're up.
So, Dr. Shaw, regarding your research, you know, I noticed that the countries that you examine share some commonality, popular culture, you know, maybe a language. Mm-hmm. And so where would your research take you if you were to examine countries in the other continents, like South America, Africa, Asia, if you were to look at that ratio, that gender ratio? Where do you, I'm not sure if you have or not, but where would you project the results to be?
Just to be clear, the statistics I had up at the beginning of my slide were taken from an organization that's called the Sydney School Board, and they it's their data, so it's not my data. However, I would guess that those countries would be slightly lower in terms of women's representation. That's a guess. The countries that were up on the board there have had funding, have quite strong government funding of their elite sport. They have had in place pressures related to funding to encourage numbers of women across the board, and in particular the Commonwealth countries, so Australia, Canada, New Zealand, and England. Although England were low, but I don't know, who knows with England. So if those policies are not in place, then I strongly suspect there will be lower numbers.
So in terms of researching women in other countries in those continents, resources may be lacking, which could be another barrier for us getting answers about what it might look like or what it looks like.
Yeah, and those government pressures in those Commonwealth countries have certainly kickstarted a lot of those changes. And you're right, where there are fewer resources, we see fewer financial pressures to change because there are fewer resources to make those changes. But yeah, it's a great point. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Leo. Well, we probably could field about 20 more questions. I can feel the energy in the room of people wanting to ask. So I would invite you, if you would like to talk to Dr. Shaw, Dr. Fink afterwards, or continue the conversation out in the lobby, please do so. Let's give these two a very big applause for their thoughts tonight. Thank you all for coming. There's some refreshments in the lobby, and please help yourself to the DVDs and materials on your way out. Thank you.